It's green on La Palma, the greenest of the Canary Islands. But once a year, the green beauty shines in white at the Island Carnival. On the Canary Islands, you take it easy. Life and obstacles. The Atlantic island La Palma is a rugged beauty, pristine and charming, and spared from mass tourism. Despite the fascinating landscape and botanical features, such as the dragon trees. Almost half of the island is covered with forest. This is a record in the Canary Islands. The inhabitants therefore call their green island La Isla Bonita, the beautiful island. Santa Cruz is the capital of the island with about 16,000 inhabitants. From here, the Spaniards set off from the 16th century onwards to settle the New World. The city has become rich as a trade junction between Europe and America. The strong connection between Santa Cruz and Cuba is still noticeable today, especially during the annual carnival. Dia de los Indianos is the name of the festival. Indianos is the name given to the Spaniards who emigrated to America and Cuba and returned to La Palma as rich people. Wealthy, dressed in white and with conspicuously pale makeup, so they say. Even the youngest children come to the carnival in white, a festival of generations. Victor Diaz Molina is here with his whole family. He's a veteran of the White Carnival. Everyone powders themselves and mocks the arrogant returnees.
Our island is the first one where carnival was celebrated in this way. In fact, since the 17th century. The people here are very special. I myself took part as a small boy, and since the 1980s, I've been involved in this carnival.
The little carnival on Sunday is for the children. The next day, the white madness really starts. Then it's Rose Monday, and up to 70,000 people are expected on the streets of Santa Cruz. In total, about 82,000 people live on La Palma. The people are known as Palmeros. The island is located about 400 kilometers from the African coast. It is the most northwestern of the Canary Islands and about as large as the city of Hamburg. Fertile volcanic soils, humid Atlantic climate, and mild temperatures make some of the valleys on La Palma real jungle. Already the first settlers, the Ahuaritas, did agriculture and cattle breeding. Probably goats were already kept here in the 5th century BC. Not exactly easy on the mountainous island. Then the Ahuaritas had the idea. They took long wooden poles to conquer the rough terrain. The shepherd's jump was born, the salto del pastor. Meanwhile, a cross-country sport for tradition-conscious palmeros. Manolo Villalba is head of the El Paso local group. He has arranged to meet other pole jumpers to train a little bit in the mountains of La Palma.
It's not a competition. We're not competitors. Everyone jumps through the terrain as they can. In the past, the shepherds were on their own, and the poles were part of their work, part of their normal locomotion. Today, we're mostly in groups, also because one shouldn't go into the mountains alone.
The Salto del Pastor is a popular sport, without problems for young people. Javi is the youngest of the group at the age of 15.
I always thought pole jumping is exciting. My grandfather was a shepherd and drove small herds across the island. It was with him that I saw the pole jump for the first time. From then on, I always wanted to go with him. Then he built my first pole, and I was allowed to go with him and the other shepherds.
The pole helps to overcome small hills quickly, as well as to descend steep slopes. It is nothing for untrained people.
You have the dominant hand at the bottom and the other at the top. You have to try to keep the pole as close to your body as possible, because it can happen that it slides up.
Javi is brave. He overcomes almost 6 meters.
This is called the leap of the dead peak, when one jumps and doesn't know where the pole will end up. When pole and shepherd are in the air together, it's a real death jump. Yabi has that in his blood.
The Atlantic is rough. The coasts of La Palma are steep and inhospitable. Relaxed bathing on La Palma, this is possible almost only in the natural seawater-filled baths, well protected from the merciless surf of the Atlantic. Constancio Ballesteros Megan is not on the way to the next natural bath, but to his wine cellar, and it is on the bottom of the sea. Constancio belongs to the pioneers of the Bodega Submarina.
People probably think I'm crazy, but the underwater storage has advantages. The wine matures better because of the darkness, the constant temperature, and also because of the constant water pressure.
Since 2007, the winemaker has been experimenting with underwater wine. In the beginning, he relied on the support of friends from the local diving club. But now, Constancio's winery has a permanent diving team. Today, they want to store a few bottles of the new vintage underwater, in top secret places that only they can find again via GPS.
The cork also plays an important role. We tried a lot and had a lot of setbacks and spoiled wine. But now we've found the perfect cork that can withstand the pressure of the water and still allows the wine to breathe.
How the wine breathes underwater remains Constancio's secret. He prefers to keep the results of his many years of study to himself. In any case, the wine from the water should have a very special character. This time they'll store 10 bottles at a depth of 15 meters. The problem? The Atlantic is often very turbulent here. The current is enormous. The precious drinks could be washed away or spilled by sediments. That's why Constancio and his team have clamped lockable steel cages between the rocks. The bottles are now stored in there for at least a year.
The wine is maturing now. It doesn't get older, but matures. Especially the red wines benefit from being down there. The wines, polyphenols and tannins, mature very well under these circumstances.
After a long series of tests, the winemaker rated the underwater wine as more aromatic than the classic wine, matured in the cellar. Nobody knows exactly what the reason for this is. Maybe the temperature of the water plays a role, the movement by the sea, the light. The wine is probably the only one who knows the answer, because in it lies the truth. Next, the winemaker wants to test the rosado, a sparkling rosé wine. His crew pulls a net of bottles on board.
Let's go. Let's try it now.
Matured for a year at a depth of 20 meters and well shaken. In total, Constancio distributed almost 1,200 bottles of wine at selected points in the water, at different depths.
The time on the seabed has changed the wine, and now it connects with the sea air. And the longer it stays in the glass, the more it will tell us about how good it feels.
The vineyard of Constancio and his wife Nancy is, of course, near the coast. The elaborate storage in the sea makes this grape juice special and particularly expensive. 120 euros for a bottle of sparkling wine and 80 euros for the wines.
The sea has decorated the bottles in very different ways. Each one is unique. It always depends on where they have been. The outer bottles have more sediments and shells than the inner ones, which were a little more protected.
Tienen menos.
The entire old town center of Santa Cruz is considered an architectural monument, Spanish colonial style, very well preserved. Victor Diaz Molina lives on the edge of the city. It's Rose Monday, and Victor has to have makeup done by his wife Olga and Carolina, a friend of the family. The former port police officer becomes the star and favorite of the carnival.
I was about 20 years old when this carnival started. People started to dress up like the returnees from Cuba and throw powder. They did whatever they wanted. All of that was gradually named Los Indianos.
In 1992, he started to dress up as La Negra Tomasa, a resolute Cuban housekeeper who makes fun of the white Spaniards.
My performances are about affection. I give something to the audience and get so much in return. Everyone who comes to the big square for the carnival celebration enjoys it. It's primarily about affection and love.
Over the decades, Victor's role as Cuban housekeeper has become the linchpin of the entire celebration. The carnival star is now well over 70 years old, and the performances are becoming more and more arduous for Victor, with the wig, thick makeup, and tight costume.
This year will be especially difficult. First of all, more people are supposed to come than ever before. Then there's the weather. Calima is predicted. That's hot, sandy wind from Africa. And then the sun. It'll be terrible. Under my makeup and the black cloth, it'll be as hot as in a kettle.
Nevertheless, Victor's dancing mood isn't spoiled. On the Spanish square, thousands of palmeros dressed as Cuban homecomers are already waiting for their star. Finally, Victor's performance as housekeeper Tomasa, the figure in which La Palma and Cuba, black and white, reality and carnival mix up. Victor's dance interlude is the starting signal for the biggest party of the year.
My dears, long live carnival. Long live Negra Tomasa.
From now on until the early morning, there is dancing, partying, and powdering everywhere in Santa Cruz. It is estimated that 20 tons of baby powder are blowing through the air here today.
I'm from La Palma. The carnival means a lot to me. I have never missed this festival.
This is a good tradition for us Palmeros. We symbolically celebrate all Cuban returnees.
We came from Havana for the carnival in La Palma. We enjoy the best party in the world here.
Victor's performances don't take very long anymore.
My performance is quite exhausting, but I'll keep going as long as I can.
But slowly, Victor is planning his succession. Maybe next year his son will be the new housekeeper, Tomasa. Most of the Palmeros live in small villages, do agriculture, and use the extraordinarily fertile soil of the island. Strelitzia thrive here perfectly. A green paradise with agaves, aloe vera, and cacti. Manolo Villalba lives and works in the village of El Paso. He doesn't only practice the shepherd's jump, he's also the only craftsman on the Canary Islands who creates the poles.
This pole should be ready for a jumper now.
Manolo is a jack of all trades. He can forge, carpenter, and also works as a locksmith from time to time. He makes the poles for the Salto del Pastor, the shepherd's jump, in a very traditional way. The tip is hand-forged. The actual vaulting pole is sliced from a piece of canary pine by Manolo.
I started building the poles myself because I didn't know where to get one. That was the time when the Salto del Pasto was booming. Over the years, it became a real off-road sport.
Manolo needs about 8 hours for a pole, including forged tip. For the large ones, almost 3 meters 50 long, he takes 150 euros.
I think I've probably already built 1,000 of them. I haven't counted them, but that's about right. In the beginning, I made considerably more. Suddenly, there was this new boom of the Canarian culture, and everybody wanted to be a jumping shepherd.
And then it's finished. His 1,001st pole. La Palma is so green because the wind often blows Atlantic clouds over the island, which rain down on the high ridges. Only a few minutes by car up into the mountains, and you are above the clouds. And there, the Canarian freedom is boundless. In the port of Tasakote, there has been excitement for a few days. Everything started with a rumor. The tuna fish is here. Then the fishing authorities gave the green light, and the fishermen of La Palma were allowed to set sail. Antonia Hernandez is the only fish wholesaler on the island. She's excited as tuna is still the most valuable thing the fishermen here get from the Atlantic.
Tell me finally how it went. Tell me, how was the fishing today?
The crew of the first cutter have yellowfin tuna, a lot of it. This could be a long night for Antonia. And then one cutter after another comes into the port of Tasakote. Splendid specimens are caught by the fleet, even bigger than what the fishmonger has seen in a long time.
I bet it weighs over 200 pounds. Really huge. Worth around 3,000 euros. A quality product. It gets a label of origin right away.
The next one is even bigger, bluefin tuna. The species was overfished for a long time. Last year, the International Commission for the Protection of Tuna increased the catch quota for Canary Island fishermen again to 438.5 tons because the stocks had recovered. One third of the allowed quota was not used this year.
It is only a few days during which the tuna is off the island and the boats of our fleet are very small. They can't load more than 5 or 6 fish.
Only a part of the catch remains on La Palma. For the restaurants of the island. Most of the tuna is flown to Madrid, the largest Spanish fish market. La Palma is a volcanic island. It is covered with lava fields and craters. The biggest crater, the Saldera de Taburiente, is a national park. almost 8 kilometers in diameter and 1.5 kilometers deep. A biosphere reserve with enormous biodiversity. On the Roque de los Muchachos are the most powerful telescopes in Europe, at an altitude of almost 2,500 meters. No clouds, no big city lights, so the view on a starry sky is guaranteed, almost 365 nights a year. This attracts stargazers from all over the world. Ana Garcia is an astrophysicist. She worked in research for many years, but working with computers was too boring for her in the long run. She founded her own company. Now, Ana organizes nightly star tours and rents out telescopes.
Stars have been my passion since childhood. When I was 7, I got up almost every night and looked at the starry sky. I liked it so much. Today, I have made this passion my profession.
Customers from Finland. The man from Helsinki finally wants to watch the constellation Ursa Major on a clear night sky. He decides for a rental telescope with 1200 millimeter focal lengths.
Do you?
No, 1 to 2.
It's very cloudy normally in Finland, so if you go the weekend, it's few times in winter when you have access, good weather.
Anna has another tip for the stargazer.
The very southern point is really, really dark. And around 6 in the morning, you should be able to see the Southern Cross. Okay, good luck.
Renting a telescope for a day costs 35 euros at Anna's. She herself wants to go on a star safari with a small group the next night.
Okay, see you tomorrow.
Okay,
bye.
The salt works of Fuencaliente is one of the last active sea salt production plants on the Canary Islands. In 1972, the plant had to be temporarily closed because the neighboring volcano erupted, the Tenaguilla, and the lava flowed into the sea close to the basins. Since then, the salt is cold like the volcano. The steep slopes on the west coast hide a mystery. A whole settlement in a rocky grotto. Porris de Candelaria, hard to find and only accessible with great difficulty. Smugglers and pirates used to hide here. Today, a kind of senior citizens community lives here. Severo Cruz has had a small hut in the community for 20 years. Alvaro Rodriguez is new.
Look, Alvaro, this path was only finished in 1921. And just imagine, there used to be no path at all here.
Yeah. Severo inherited his place in the cave from his uncle, and he's proud of what he has made of it.
Boy, how beautiful it is.
Not bad, right? Right on the waterfront.
Severo is no less proud of his small kitchen and the always well-filled refrigerator.
That's not possible. Everything is full of beer and wine.
Would you like a sip?
But only a very small one.
A little wine never hurts.
Under the kitchen, driven into the rock, is Severo's bedroom.
Down here, I even have a guest bed. When the whole family comes to visit, I can accommodate them all. Then some can sleep down here, and the others up here. This is all rock, behind this wall too, an apartment in the rock. Saltpeter is leaking from the rock all the time. The white, strange stuff trickles down here like that. I had to do something about it. I plastered the wall. Just put mortar on it, problem solved.
The hardcore of the grotto community is once again playing bingo with wine from their own cultivation.
68. We are like a family. Most of us have known each other since childhood. We all come from these surrounding villages and grew up together. Everyone here knows the life story of the other. And now we bring our children and grandchildren here. That's wonderful.
Encantado, Lidia. 69, 77, my dears.
77,
Guajo. Oh, I've got that. There you go. Bingo. Who's got 90?
Severo has to go back into his little cave. There's always something to do. Only a few months ago, a big renovation was due because a monster wave crashed into the cave. Still a topic of conversation today.
On that day, the sea was really not as friendly as it is today. It was really rough, brutal. The huge wave crashed against the rock up to here. It ran down the walls, crawled into the cave at the back. Water everywhere, in every room. The huge wave literally rolled over us.
Up above at the entrance to the cave, Alvaro, the new man, stands around on his newly built terrace. This must be celebrated with freshly picked avocados, oranges, and his own wine. Salute to friendship in seclusion. Puerto Naos on the west coast is a classic seaside resort with promenade, palm trees, and party. Here, Manolo Villalba, the shepherd, carpenter, and blacksmith, finds a change from village life. He's a musician and loves rock and roll. Tonight, he plays a concert in his sister's beach bar.
To me, it's completely normal that you do such different things. That's important on such a small island. It's very quiet here. You have a lot of spare time. You don't want to get bored. I simply always have to do something.
Manolo's wife Raquel is also in the band. The singer is a big fan of the 50s, like Manolo.
We got to know each other here on the island by chance. I was visiting my family. We ran into each other and saw that we were dressed quite similarly. We liked each other immediately, and since then, well...
Let's hear it for the North African rockabilly queen, for Kelly Cat.
The North African rockabilly queen, please clap your hand for Kelly Cat.
One hand goes down, one hand returned, gonna rock my baby tonight. Put a dime in the slot, what to do God? Who'll I rock and who'll I rock? Gonna rock my baby tonight. Gonna rock my baby tonight. When the jukebox playing,
shortly after sunset, on a parking lot above Santa Cruz.
Hola. Hola.
Good evening. How are you? Everybody
Hola.
Ready?
Hola. ¿Qué tal? Hola.
Ana Garcia, the astrophysicist, goes on a star safari with a small group of guests.
It is something special when you can look up into a clearly visible starry sky, just like us. Unfortunately, in most places in the world, there is far too much light pollution.
The sky over La Palma is so exceptionally clear that the island was classified by UNESCO in 2012 as the world's first starlight reserve. A star reserve. Milky Way. Constellations, planets, the moon. Anna takes her guests on an interstellar journey through space.
A little question. What we see now, what is that?
That's Venus.
Not a star?
No, the planet Venus. The first thing you have to remember, the North Star is not the brightest in the sky, okay? There are three steps to find it. First, we look for the constellation Ursa Major. The back of the chariot is extended, and that shows us the way to the North Star. Looking at the stars is like admiring the landscape of a national park, or like a sunset on the beach. Rare, beautiful moments that make us marvel at the inexplicable, infinite vastness.
A sea of stars, a sea of flowers, a sea of clouds in the Atlantic Ocean. What more can you ask for?